because we spent a little bit here.
He did?
Yeah.
He
the thing about the East Coast is that if you get it here in North Carolina, you feel it all the way up to Canada, because we have a solid rock of our continental shelf that just goes all the way up, whereas California is all ruptured and it doesn't transmit.
Where was the epicenter?
In Virginia, just south of Washington.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna see if we're on the level.
Okay, check her blouse and her pendant.
This doesn't
show. Yeah, let me look at that. Yeah, it looks good from here. Okay. There you go. Okay. Exquisite. Yeah, we both have an eye for beauty.
Okay.
Don't we?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, she's got a box around her head.
Sure it's not a halo?
I would unzoom it a little bit, because you never know how things will clip when you do various things to it. Maybe a little bit right there. I like that, and then the edge of the curtain. She's just about dead soon. That's good enough.
After this, I'm going to become a movie star.
Or a face right in the center of the screen. I like that, Miss Nydia. Miss Nydia. Miss Nydia.
Yes.
Okay,
mama. They are taking a movie, and I'm the star.
Okay.
Pepper ain't got nothing on you.
So don't move it off of her, and you don't need to cut it off. We can edit out anything that you capture when I tell her the next thing. You know how to do it.
I had a good teacher.
Oh, there you go.
The first video you took was my baptism.
That is a fact.
So I was learning then, Daddy.
And I'm telling you, that priest really liked to be a star. We went down, and when there was no one else in the church, and he went through, starting back at the back of the church, and said some things and explained it, and then we walked halfway down the aisle, and we got all the way down, we got over to the side, we came back, and I mean, I've never had a baptism like that before. You should really be baptized. Like me, she was. All right, okay, that's good. Okay, Mama's going to start by telling about her six-year undergraduate scholarship to go to school and how that came about. She had taken an exam for it, and it was all room and board. And let me see. And the year, I'll mention the year to you, that would have been your 6 years there and a year, 7 years before 48, so about 1941. So this is around 1941. Okay, I could put all of that in, but okay, Mom, look into the camera. Mm-hmm. You don't have to say when, just start with your...
I am not, don't you?
Dad, sit over here, so she looks this way when you talk. I'll get another chair.
Oh,
and
yeah.
You sit closer to the camera, and so when she looks at you to talk, she can be looking towards the camera.
I'll do that, sure.
We'll get two chairs that way.
All right. And one pillow.
Here's a pillow.
Mm-hmm. That's not it. Yeah, this is the pillow for a chair. Oh, I'm in his way now.
That's okay.
Here you go.
Well, she's
going.
Yeah, I just put this pillow here. Mm-hmm.
You can scoot up closer, actually. You don't have to be behind here. That might even be better if you're...
Oh, this is fine.
Okay.
Okay, sweetheart.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Have you started recording yet?
You're rolling.
Okay, Nana, tell us about your first six-year scholarship.
Oh, I thought she was going to ask me the questions.
Well, you go right ahead. Tell us about your first six-year scholarship, Mama.
This was when you took the exam out on the street.
Yeah, I remember. And that was in Bogotá.
Yeah, Bogotá. Yeah.
I was born in Bogotá, Colombia. I applied for a scholarship to go to high school. And one day, walking in the street with my mother, a professor stopped us and to talk to us and say, "Oh, I was one of the persons who read your exam, and you did very well in that exam, so I'm sure you are going to get your scholarship." And I said, "Oh, thank you very much." And then later on, we went to the Minister of Education to see if the scholarship had arrived. And it turned out that it had not. And so we were sitting, waiting to talk again while they looked for the scholarship. And there was a lady sitting next to us, and she was talking to another lady. And she told the other lady, "And I paid 500 pesos, and they didn't give the scholarship for my son." And my mother told me to be quiet, not to say anything. And I sat there waiting to go inside to talk to the Minister of Education. And in the meanwhile, my mother went to the telephone and she called like Time magazines, Del Tiempo. And immediately, just a few minutes later, a man from El Tiempo came. And my mother had told him that there was a lady there who had paid for the scholarship. And so he went and talked to the lady, and she told him, "Yes, I paid the money and they didn't give me the scholarship." And so he says, "Don't you worry, I will take care of it." So immediately he went back to the El Tiempo, where they published the paper, the daily paper. And the next morning the paper appeared, and there was a big sign in the first page, "Scholarships being sold." And of course that was totally against the law. So there was a big problem, and the person in charge of the education, the Minister of Education, was thrown out of the job. And then they had the Minister of Foreign Relations to cover both for a while. So then I was supposed to go back. And at that time I went back, and the Minister of Foreign Relations was there instead of the Minister of Education. And I told him I was waiting for the scholarship. He said, "Oh yes, I have it ready." And so he went and gave me the scholarship. And this Minister of Education that was taking the job of the Minister of Education, the Minister of Foreign Relations, was a very elegant man. He was a very tall man and very well dressed. And he looked like a movie actor, you know, very handsome man. And he immediately gave me my scholarship. So I said, "Oh, thank you, doctor, very much," and all that. And so I got my scholarship. And then, of course, the people who had paid and all that, there was a big surprise. All over the news and the radio and everything talking about that situation, that somebody was trying to sell scholarships. And so things changed. And at any rate, I got my scholarship, so I went to school. And the scholarship was very nice because it was room and board. So we have a place to stay and we have food to eat. And so I went there and I graduated from after that. And that was a high school graduation. And then later on, I wanted to go to the university. And so we have moved from there. And then I went to the university in Berkeley.
Oh, Bogotá.
Oh. In Bogotá, I went to the university. And I also got a scholarship for the university. Since I have done so well before with the others, I took the other exam and I got another scholarship. And I graduated from Bogotá. And while I was in Bogotá, I met a girl who came to Bogotá to be there for a year. and she was from Santa Barbara, California. And she had come to write about a former president of Colombia. She was going to write about him. And so we became good friends. And she says, when I go back to the States, I want you to come back with me. And I said, that will be very nice, but I don't know any English and I don't have any money. She says, no problem. You learn English when you get there and you can work when you get there. And so I told my mother, and she knew Mimi, but the friend invited me, and she thought that that would be very nice. But then she started talking to friends and relatives, and they say, are you crazy? She's doing great here, going to the United States. That's a terrible country, and a lot of awful things can happen to her, and you'll never see her again. So then my mother says, you cannot go. So I told my friend, I'm sorry, but my mother doesn't want me to go. And so I was a little disappointed, but I said, well, that's it. And lo and behold, a few days later, the person who was running for president was coming down to lunch, you know, at noontime. And as he was coming down the steps, there was a man who was going up the steps, and as soon as he was very close to him, he took a gun and killed him. And then there was another guy behind him who killed that guy. And immediately, it was total chaos in Bogotá. They start burning all the buildings that were government buildings, started to burn. And it was just unbelievable. And I was immediately, I said, oh, I got to go find my friend because she's a foreigner and she's going to be very scared of this. So I went and I found her at the American embassy where she was working. And then we start walking because the street guards were turned over and all the buildings were burning and it was just unbelievable. So we walked and we ran into two little girls, one like about 10 and the other 10, and they were crying. And we said, don't you cry, we'll take you to your house. She took one and I took the other girl. And we walked and to get them to their house. And after that, we kept walking and walking and walking. And in the meanwhile, there were people that will come by us and say, would you like a gun? No, thank you, we don't want a gun. Would you like a gun? No, thank you, we don't want a gun. And then the bullets were flying on top of our heads because people were hitting everything that they could. And so bullets were flying, but I didn't think I was scared because it just didn't look real. It was like I was looking at a movie, you know, about that. But we were very lucky that they didn't kill us because the bullets fly very close to our heads. And anyway, finally, after walking and walking, we made it to the boarding house where we live. And we entered and closed the door, and it was such a relief to be out of all that fire. And lo and behold, I thought I wasn't scared, but I could not eat or drink anything for a week. I just couldn't swallow. And so then I realized I really had been scared. So finally, after I was able to call my mother on the phone because the phones were not working, nothing was working, I finally called her and said, my university is closed. There is no more university. It burns closed. Where am I going to study? She said, okay, you can go to the States. So then I called my friend and told her I can come, and she was very happy. And so that is how I was able to come to the States.
That was the summer of 1948.
Well, so at any rate, then she, her father was a doctor, and he was the director of Santa Barbara Clinic. And she invited me to come with her, but we didn't go directly to Berkeley, but we went through a lot of places. We went by Cuba, we went by several countries on the trip, so that we got to see a lot of other things, and Mexico and several places. So it was a very interesting trip. We had a great trip, and I didn't have money for the trip, but she paid for my trip because she had the money. Her father was rich and done, so she paid for my trip. And then when I got to Santa Barbara, the first 6 months, we were visiting all these beautiful mansions where all the millionaires live. And they were very nice people. But all I could say is, hello, goodbye, thank you. That was all the English I knew. But I met all the very most important people in Santa Barbara. And then Mimi's mother decided that I should take 2 classes of English a week so I will learn enough English to go to university. And so they got me a teacher who will come 2 times a week and gave me some English classes. And then at the end of the 6 months, Mimi came for Christmas, and after that she took me to Berkeley, California, and I went to school at Berkeley. She was going to school at Stanford University, but Stanford was much more expensive university. Berkeley was very little what I had to pay there. And so I went to Berkeley, and then soon after I arrived, I found that I could work there because we have room and board there, and I got a job in the cafeteria. So I worked 3 hours a day from 6 to 9 every day, and they paid me $3 a day. And then at the end of the month, they let me sign the checks, but they didn't let me cash them. They put them in the bank for my money to save it, you know. And so later on, I had money to pay for the university and to buy the books and all of that. And
it was interesting in Santa Barbara how the people in the laboratory helped you learn English by tagging things.
Oh yes, when I was, everybody wanted to, you know, they felt sorry for me because I didn't know any English and it was difficult. But everybody put names on all of these things. They put chair, table, everything. They wrote the names for me to learn. And then they everybody was trying to do something good for me. And there was one of them, Ruth Schertz, that she really was just like a mother to me. And so she will tell me, is anything that you need, anything that you want, anything. And if there was anything at all that I asked for, I always got it. And one time, she and I were waiting for a bus. And we were on the street waiting. And all of a sudden, some people that were standing next to us were talking and talking and talking, and I didn't get a word out of it. And so I was about to cry because I was beginning to learn a little English and hear these people talk and I didn't get anything. And so she says, what's the matter with you? She said, those people talk and I couldn't understand anything. She said, don't be silly, that was German. So anyway.
How did your French come into play there in Santa Barbara?
Oh, when I was in Santa Barbara, Mimi's mother spoke French. So the little French I have learned in Colombia was very helpful because not that I spoke much French, but that little French helped me a lot. And so that worked out very well. And when I was in Santa Barbara, the Coffetts, the people I was staying with, they did not go to church, but they knew that I went to church on Sundays. So they will go and take me, leave me at the church, then come home, and then go back and take me out. Finally, after a while, they decided, instead of going and taking me and come back home and go back to pick me up, they start to go in church with me. And lo and behold, later on, they became Catholics.
Because they converted them.
Well, they decided to become Catholics, yes.
Tell about Dr. Coford and what he had in Santa Barbara. his laboratory that you worked in.
Oh yeah.
Not Berkeley, in Santa Barbara.
Yeah, he had his lab, and I worked there. And
your first years, I guess you were in college a year in Bogota, and when you were there for that year.
Yeah, I had learned how to do lab work in Bogota. And of course, that lab work was the same in Santa Barbara. So they put me to work there, and I made money because they paid me for working at the lab.
What was your interview like when you went to the laboratory to get a job?
Well, the doctor, Coffett, was in charge of the lab, and he knew that I didn't speak very much. So he talked to the lady in charge of the lab and said, this girl doesn't speak much English, but she knows how to do lab work. You check her out, and if she does well, we are going to hire her. And they put the work, and they checked my work, and they realized I could do the work. So then they hired me. And then all of the people who were at the lab were very nice to me because they felt sorry, you know, somebody who doesn't speak the language and all that. So everybody was always trying to, if there is anything you need, tell me. And one that was very, very good to me was Ruth Schertz. And Ruth Schertz, during the lunchtime, we went out to lunch together, or she brought the lunch in the lab and we ate at the lab. And she was the one who made my face, you know, that statue that...
The bust.
While I was sitting down for her to play, and I would be eating my lunch, and she was working on that, because she was very good about doing that. In fact, later on she did some sculptures in Santa Barbara.
Yes, there was a brother and a sister, I don't recall their last name, who really were responsible for Santa Barbara having the colonial Spanish atmosphere that it has, and they dedicated a park to the two of them down at the foot of the where you go out to the pier at Santa Barbara. And she did a face relief, which is probably about twice full size of the face, and that appears on a stone monument that you pass by when you go in.
Was the one who, you have seen the one that, anyway. Now, and so...
Dr. Coford was one of the few doctors who made house calls, which was the reason you had the opportunity to do the visit
And so when he went to house calls, he would take me with him. And that's how come I went to all these beautiful mansions of Santa Barbara, where the very rich people lived. And I met all of those people, but I couldn't talk very much to
them. Leonor knew how to take blood, and if they needed to have a blood test when they did a home call, she was with him to help out.
And so it really, it turned out, no English, no money, no problem.
But what about your paperwork as far as, did you have a visa, did you have a study permit? What did you need,
actually,
and how did you get it?
I went with immigration visa. I could not go as a tourist, because that was only for 6 months. And the only way I wanted to stay there, and I could not go as a student because I didn't know English. So I had to go as a resident. And it wasn't so easy to get a visa for resident. But I think, I don't know exactly what happened, but all of a sudden, they called me from the American embassy. I had tried to apply, but I didn't know. And they called me, come pick up your visa. And when I went to pick it up, it was visa, immigrant visa or immigration. And I don't know whether Dr. Coffey or Mimi might have had known somebody in the American embassy and told them to. But they gave me, and hardly anybody, even people very rich, couldn't get visas. Immigration visas to Santa Barbara, to California.
So you had all of your paperwork in order before you even got to the U.S.?
Yeah. And so...
Then they had that rebellion, it was called. And if you Google Bogota Zoo, spelled B-O-G-O-T-A-Z-O, you'll find photographs of the streetcars burning, turned over for this, and probably only 20% of Bogota was left in state after the rampage. And it was at the occasion that they were having a Pan-American conference, just before the elections, and people from all of the countries there were present, and the person who going to represent the United States there was General Marshall of the Marshall Plan. He was the chief leading delegate at that point. And Leonor, when she went in after, she could take a streetcar into the embassy, but when she left, they were burning, and she had to do that long walk afterwards. But when she went upstairs to get Mimi and came downstairs, she had an encounter.
Yeah, with the general.
Yeah, you met General Marshall.
General Marshall got in and saw the two ladies. He saluted them. And then after they got out, Mimi asked Leonor, did you know who that was? General Marshall.
That was General Marshall that we met.
And Glenn's godmother, Olguita Santa Thomas, we were talking with her last week and discussed, you know, the Bogota Zoo with a friend that she had with her. And she said she remembered the occasion. Fidel Castro went to that conference, and immediately after this occurred, he got on the radio out there and said, this is a communist revolution, and started announcing on one of the radios there. I mean, it is an event that is in history, and anybody in South America knows that rebellion that it took to get Leonor to come.
He survived a rebellion, huh?
Yep.
Another
interesting thing, honey, that you have told us about is meeting Francis Morrow, who later moved to San Francisco, and how that tied in with your university studies at Berkeley during the summer times.
Yeah.
She and the other two ladies moved over to an apartment
in
San Francisco.
Yeah, and I have met one of them at the lab.
Mm-hmm.
And they moved to San Francisco, and so they wanted me to move with them. So I moved.
This was during the summer when you were between semesters.
I moved there for the semester, for during the vacation. But I wanted to, and I have free room and board, because they won't let me pay a penny for being there. And they cook very well, since I didn't know how to cook, and they cook very nice meals. And so I have room and board free of charge. And I had already a lot of clothes from my other friends, so I had it made. And then I decided I want to get a job for while I'm there. So I just, but I couldn't write a resume and say I do this and I do that. So I just went to San Francisco, and I saw some looking the Pacific Medical Lab. So I said, a lab. So I went to the lab, and I asked to talk to the person in charge of the lab. And I said, I work some at Santa Barbara Clinic. I know how to do lab work, but my English is not very good. I work for you free for a week, and if after the week you don't want me, no problem. He said, can you start today? And so they say yes. So they gave me a white coat, and they put me to work, and they checked my work, and so I got me a job.
And that was a summer job for each of her four summers.
And then all of the people that I met there were very nice to me too, because they said, poor girl that doesn't speak much English, and you know, so everybody was always sort of adopted me, and they, I really was very, very lucky.
You mentioned already that you worked as a salad girl at the restaurant, and what location was that at Berkeley?
That was the International House. The International House, where I got that other job, and I worked there at the salad bar, and that was not a good place to learn English, because the people living there were from 70 different countries, and they spoke all sorts of languages. I could understand what was French and English, but some of the other languages I had no idea, because we had people from all over. And so, you heard this language and that. But at any rate, one time when I was working there, there was a man. Most people were very friendly with me, and they will smile, say hello, thank you, or you know. But there was a man who looked like he hated the war, and he never talked, he never looked, he just went by, pick up his food. And I said, I was very curious. I was wondering what's happening to this man. So one day that I wasn't working and I was going to eat my dinner, he was eating by himself in a table. So I decided I will go sit with him to see if I could find out what his problem with him. So I went and said, can I sit with you? And he says, okay. So he said, we were eating, and when we were eating, he had some numbers on his ear, in his arm. And I have never seen people having numbers on the arm. So I said, what's that? You know, I wanted to find out. He said, let me tell you. My family, I was in Germany, and they killed my mother, my father, my sisters, my brothers, everybody. I was the only one who could escape from there. It was just unbelievable because I had never heard of all these things that had happened on the World War II, you know, when so many people were killed. And so, I felt so kind of badly that I have asked, you know, but at the same time, I think it was good that he could tell somebody, you know. At any rate, he will later on pass and say hello to me at the salad bar, and I will say, hi, how are you? And, you know, so I, and later on, no, a few weeks later, I ran into a girl from, he was Jewish too. And I decided to, so I became friends with her. And then one day I say, I have a friend too that I want you to meet. So I went and introduced her to this guy, and they became very good friends, and they got married to each other later on.
You're the matchmaker.
Yeah, because they were both Jewish, and they were both had gone through a lot of problems. And so, it's difficult to run into somebody that you know, especially when there are people from so many countries and all that. You know. But I was able to meet this other girl, and so that was, yeah.
When the International House would periodically take a group of people to another town, and each person would represent a different country, and the town would host them, and they would give some talks, and each one would tell a little bit about their country. And Leonor always had an interesting way of describing where Colombia was when they asked, where is Colombia?
Many of the people that I have talked to, some of them were very, you know, I came from England or something, I came from this part. And some of them, I've forgotten what was, there were some people who were very, they felt like they were better than the rest of the world. But I've forgotten what country it was that they were from.
Upper class. Huh?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some very wealthy people and all that. At any rate, after one of them talked about his country and did it so, making himself like he came from a very special place, then I said, I am originally from Bogotá, Colombia. And Colombia was named after Christopher Columbus. And Christopher Columbus discovered America, and when he went to discover America, he went with two friends, and they were the Pinzón brothers, and Pinzón is my name.
They were actually the captains of the ship, and some of the school books will mention their by name.
And so I might be related to the mm-hmm. ones who discovered America, because all these other people were trying to overdo everybody. And so, at any rate, I gave them a good talk about, you know, how Christopher Columbus did that, and how Colombia was named after Christopher Columbus. That's the only country in the world that recognizes Christopher Columbus, Colombia.
And everybody knows where Panama is and its origin.
Yeah. And so, I will always come up with something to come out of the sea, but you know, that I was the only Colombian at that time there, so they asked me to talk about my country, so I had to say something.
I think it's a very interesting storytelling about your relationship to your advisor when you came to this country and your selection of courses when you first got started in Berkeley.
Oh, yeah. Since my English was not so good and I was going to the university, if I went to the advisor, they will tell me, take history, some things that I have to read a lot and write a lot, which I couldn't do. So I decided I better select my own courses, and then just go when there was a line, long line, and the person was in a hurry to get to have his dinner, and then I will just say, would you please sign? And I selected what I want. So I looked through the calendar, through the thing, and I say, of course, I take Spanish because I know Spanish. I take English because I got to learn English. I take French because I know a little French, very few words. So that's three courses right there. But I need another course. And I said, what course? And I look at, biochemistry 103 and 104.
Now let me say that at Berkeley, the 100 level courses are junior and senior courses, and those less than 100 are the freshman courses. She had already finished 1 year down in Colombia, and your major in Colombia was?
Bacteriology.
And that's what you majored in at Berkeley.
Yeah.
So she had had some courses which could have, you know, been a prerequisite, and that's what gave her the gumption to try the junior level course at Berkeley.
And so I decided I'd take biochemistry 103 and 104, and that was a 7-unit course. Well, it turned out that it was very difficult to get into that course. So I went to countries, and the professor said, no, I'm sorry, I cannot. The class is full, and I don't have room for anymore. But I won't take no for an answer, and every morning I'd be there at 8 o'clock when he arrived. Doctor, please, I need that, because when I go back to my country, I'm going to open a laboratory, and I need to take this course. Please let me in. I cannot. There's no way. So finally, one day I say, listen, doctor, I am from Bogotá, Colombia, and you Americans stole Panama from my country. The least you can do is to let me into your class. He said, okay, you're in.
And I don't know if you know the history of that, but it was the first president, Roosevelt, in 1900, who wanted to build a Panama Canal through Colombia. And Panama was not separated at that time, and Colombia didn't want to let them have it. So they got together with the people who lived in that section of Panama to succeed and to have a revolution. And they fomented a revolution and said, we'll have our military ships out in the harbor, should anything go astray while you undertake this venture. But it turned out that the American ships got there before they started the revolution. But nevertheless, they had the revolution, and that's how we ended up with Panama from Colombia. That was interesting.
So I got in the class, and then people asked me, how did you get in that class? I said, I don't know. Because it was very difficult. And of course, later on, it was a difficult course. But fortunately, I knew how to do the lab work part. And my lab work always was perfect. And another thing was this, that when I was in Colombia studying, we could help each other. Somebody said, how do you do this? And you say, this is the way to do it. And we help each other. Well, when I went to this in the United States, nobody will help anybody. And finally, I asked another friend, when I ask anybody, how do you do this? They say, I don't know. So let me tell you something. Nobody is going to help you, because here they grade by curve. And if you get a good grade, that means they get a bad grade. Nobody is going to help you. And I was about to cry. I says, welcome to the United States of America. And I said, it wasn't that way in my country. And I couldn't understand how they could be that mean. And so you could never. So later on, when I did all my lab work, and people will call me, how did you do that? I says, I don't know. So, you know, I had to do the same way. So, but I was really taught, I couldn't believe that that was true. Because in Colombia, we never did that. We just all study, and if all could get A's, fine. And if all flunked the course, all flunked the course. But this business that you have to grade by curve, and I didn't understand that.
That had another interesting program at the International House when you were an undergraduate, and your 4 years of being an undergraduate there was from, I guess, really January of 1949 until you graduated in 1952, which is the year I graduated from state, actually. And that was a program in which they would have open houses to introduce the foreign students to some of the faculty members that they would invite over, and you met some interesting a faculty member there, Dr. Cobb.
Oh yeah, and she also adopted me,
mm-hmm.
And so she was very, very nice, and she will have parties at her home and invite some foreign students.
You might first want to tell about how you first met her when she came by and you had your tag.
Oh yeah, I. One day, on Sundays, they used to have like an open house, and you could go, and some of the professors will come to meet the foreign students, so that they will, you know, have some friends and know somebody. And that day, I had plenty to study, and I was not even going to go, but I said, oh, I go, and I pick up some cookies, and I go to my room to eat them, and, you know. And so, but before you go in, you have to put your name on your country. And so I was picking my cookies, and this professor comes up, oh, you're from Colombia, I have been to your country. And my name is Dr. Cobb, and this and that, and she was so nice. And so anyway, we talk, and she said, oh, I have to call you and invite you to my house and all this. And lo and behold, the next week or something was Thanksgiving. And she was having a big party at her house, and so I got invited to the party at the house.
And you were invited actually several years to the Thanksgiving party at her house, and it was the one after you graduated that you're going to tell about next. After she graduated, she still invited Leonor to come by at Thanksgiving. Leonor graduated in June of 1952, and this would have been the Thanksgiving of 1952. In which you went there, and you were already working at that time, and that's where you met somebody. Jim.
Oh, yes. There was a student from, Jim Jarmes, he was from Burma, and he got invited to go to a party at Treasure Island, but he was new in the university, and he didn't know anybody, so he said, I have this invitation to go to Treasure Islands to a party, but I don't have anybody to go with. Would you like to go with me? I said, sure, I'll go with you. So I went with him to that. But to go there, he didn't have a car. And he had a friend who had a car. And the friend who had a car was this guy. And so he told this Jim Jarvis, oh, I'd be happy to take you. And so Jim Jarvis came to my house, and he said, I have a friend outside in the car that is going to take us to the party. And so I say, oh, how do they work?
Okay. There was, I guess, that Thanksgiving that you met him, and that's when he asked you to go to the party over there. Yeah, okay. Well, that would be another story about when and how we met. Jim was getting his master's in sanitary engineering. He was half French and half English, but he was a Burmese citizen. And the municipality there in the city had sponsored his to get the sanitary engineering so he could come back and work with them for a couple of years, and he had an obligation after a year and a half or 2 years to get his master's degree. And he selected the same rooming and boarding house that I did when I went out in September of 1952 to start my graduate work. And this lady had a house, and then she had a barracks outside with some rooms in it. I was in one of the barracks rooms. But for our meals, which would be breakfast and dinner in the evening, they had country or family style in which they would serve the table and you serve yourself. And I met a couple of guys there. One was from, was Jim, and another one was from South America. They were both from South Carolina. And the fellow from South Carolina became my best man, actually. But we would sit around and chat for dinner. And he told me about meeting this girl at the Thanksgiving party and invited her out, and that he described her in glowing terms. And he had a present to go out at Christmas time, which he wanted to take it out early, and Jim and I both got in the car to take it out and to deliver it, you know. And we left it at the door with the mother. She was working in the afternoon in the East Bay area at the hospital in Oakland. It was a laboratory technician during that time. And she later told me that her mother said, you know, this blind boy came up and left this present from Jim. Well, later, and it was New Year's Eve, they invited Jim over to their place. She had an apartment with her mother. Her mother had come up to take her back to South America. She was working for 6 months to save up enough money to buy instruments to carry back to start the lamp, which was a long range of objectives. And Jim trying to think of the name of the fellow from South Carolina now, but in any event, the two of us were going out, and we offered to take Jim by and to leave him for the party if he'd introduce us to her. So he knocked on the door, and we came out, and we met, and they had their party, and we had our party. And then the next week, and that would be January 1953, Jim invited her to go to a movie, and Thursday night he made the mistake of telling us at the table what their plans were. I don't know, she didn't live that close to campus. I'm not sure of the transportation, so I offered to, though I was interested in that movie, would you like for me to take you out to the movie? So we all three went out to the movie. This happened three weeks in a row. And following?
We need to get your story.
And following that 3 week period, the Thursday evening, the topic came up again. And he said, Wes, you know, I think two's company, but three's a crowd. And I didn't know what he was going to say after that with respect to the next fight. And I said, maybe you should invite her out alone. So I did, and we got engaged March 15th. We had Kevin 2 years later on March the 15th in 1955. We announced our engagement to friends at the Claremont Hotel, which is a five-star hotel in Oakland. It was an international Pan-American get-together with mostly people from the embassy and other seniors. We had a long table with Lolita and Morrison, another couple who adopted her. She hasn't told you about them yet. And it was a great occasion. And we got married on June the 14th, so less than 6 months. Well, I didn't feel too badly about what I did because I knew his situation. He not only had an obligation to go back and to work a couple of years there, but he had an obligation to his betrothed. He was engaged to be married to a girl which was back there. So I felt like I was doing both of us a favor. So
sacrifices you.
Yeah, not at all. Well, how did it all work out? Years later, after I graduated and we moved up to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, lived close to, of course, a place called Fairborn. We stayed in contact with him with Christmas cards during this period. We got a card from him saying that he was going to be visiting and coming to the United States. He had a couple of brothers that had already moved to the United States, and one of them was in upstate Ohio, in Toledo, Ohio. And he was going to visit them at Toledo, Ohio. This would have been my first year there, which would have been in 1954, 55. I'll have to think more to see which year that was. And we invited them to come down to visit us in Fairborn. They spent the weekend, and we had a delightful time, met his wife. I think he ultimately moved to the United States. We're not in touch with him now. But he obviously had told her the story, because she came over that evening to where and said something to me, said, "Thank you." So I felt completely different. But you know, everybody adopts her. You just cannot help but adopt this lady. She's been adopted by more people, and I decided I was going to be the last adoptor. that was it. That was a lovely story, sweetheart.
Yeah.
there are many others.
Very lucky, and then I have had some wonderful children.
There are many other details and aspects which are fun to talk about, but we'll do that another time.
You'd like to sit next to your bride?
Well, of course. You can slip over a notch. You might get a few notches from me. And I'll congratulate you. Give me a kiss. There you go. And we've since become inseparable. All right.
We've been blessed with some wonderful children, all of them.
So I tell everybody that if it hadn't been for that rebellion in Colombia, none of you would be here.
Yeah.
But it's interesting also that if it had not been revolution in Venezuela, we might not have been in Raleigh.
Yeah.
And most of you have not heard that story. When I was getting out of the Air Force after a couple of years there, I started interviewing for positions. I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. There was a professor that had taught some courses at from Ohio State University at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Introduction to Nuclear Engineering, and he developed a heart attack, and asked me in the middle of that to complete the course, which I did. And that was my first experience of teaching. I'd had scholarships and research assistantships, and did not do any teaching when I was out at Berkeley. So I went to a conference, the American Physical Society, before getting out. It was within a few months. And at that Physical Society conference in Pittsburgh was Professor Murray from NC State, who I was in his first class of nuclear engineering of 52, and also the head of the physics department, that was Buck Menius. And they heard that I was getting out, and they asked me who I had interviewed with, and I told them there was two or three companies, and not considered any universities. They said, "Before you make a decision, come down to the state and let us have an opportunity to talk with you." So I promised him that I would do that. Well, when I was in the Air Force, we were in the process of designing developing the functional criteria for the Air Force Nuclear Engineering Test Reactor, which was ultimately constructed there. Construction was not begun while I was there, but a lot of the planning was done. And we hired a consultant firm to help us go over the detailed plans that had been submitted to us by Parsons, a huge firm in Los Angeles, who was going to construct that. This consulting firm consisted of Wally Zinn, who was earlier the director of the University of Chicago, the National Lab, what became Fermi Lab later on.
You took me to Fermi Lab in Chicago.
Yes, we did go out there.
Yes.
He retired and resigned and took two of his chief lieutenants to start a consulting firm. His wife had a severe case of asthma, so they decided that they would locate a place for their operation that had the lowest pollen count in the United States, and that was the west coast of Florida, with all of the breezes coming in from the Gulf. And it was down at Dunedin, Florida.
and Major Bohannon, my friend who I worked with at the Air Force. He was also a student at Berkeley, a military officer who got assigned to get his master's there. So our paths crossed a couple of times, and actually three times he came back to state later. We flew down to take the plans and discuss and review it with his people. So that occurred on several occasions, and just before I was about to get out. Well, another client that this firm had was a fellow by the name of Fernandez Moran from Caracas, Venezuela. Fernandez Moran had a fantastic background. He was brilliant. He was well known throughout Venezuela, his reputation. He had an MD degree and was a surgeon, and he had been caught in World War II in Germany and was put into service and did a lot of battlefield operations. And after the war was over, he came back to Venezuela. He came up to Johns Hopkins to get his PhD in neurology or something brain related, and couple these things together. And he was sort of a poster child. He himself didn't have any political ambitions, but he was very close to P.J. Jimenez, who was the dictator of Venezuela. And he appealed directly to Jimenez to get monies to create an institute up on a mountain which overlooked Caracas. And this institute was IVNIC, the Institute, Venezuelan Institute of Brain and Neurological Research. It was a real fascinating program. And he had working for him some Swiss technicians, Swiss people who had already come out of their military duty, which is an obligation there, highly skilled scouts and that sort of thing. They loved the mountain area there. He had, among other things, one of these huge searchlights that you would find around airfields that he would, from the mountaintop, shine it through all of the valley down below. And he created a fantastic research place. It had rooms for scientists to come and had these skilled technicians. There was a lot of construction. I'll tell you more about that. One of the interesting things was, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. In any event, he wanted to have a nuclear reactor on his site as well. And he was going to get a canned nuclear reactor from General Electric made out in San Jose in near San Francisco. And he wanted someone who knew something about nuclear engineering to come down and be in charge of the nuclear reactor. So he asked these three people who had the consulting firm if they could recommend three people to send down to be interviewed by him. And I was the first one of the three to be selected. And I went down in January for the interview with him. And this happened to be the January of 1950. 56. January of 58. I was 2 years in the Air Force, 56 to 58, and 58 was when I was going to get out and do something else. And that was the fateful year in which they decided they wanted a revolution and get rid of the dictator. And the revolution began while I was there. I was in a hotel downtown. I have photographs of buses turned over burning, just like you did, in the street. And it was before I went up to the mountain for the interview. Actually, I had gone up earlier to the mountain to the interview and had come back down when that occurred. I met with him, and the interview went excellent. He showed me all around his labs about some of the things that he showed me. This is Fernandez Moran. They had something called ultra microtones, and these were devices that could cut very, very thin slivers of biological specimens like plant life or animal life. And there was a particular structure which was a very elusive statue that he had very much wanted to get. Well, these Swiss technicians made on site, these are ultra microtones. Now, what is an ultra microtone? You can think of a wagon wheel that has a hub and spokes that come out, and this would be a miniature one of those, and only one spoke would come out, and on that spoke, they would mount a tiny little specimen, and when that would go around, it would be like a lathe, and he would have over here a diamond knife. When that would go by, it would just cut a little slice off, and when it came back the next time, if it was at the same radius, it would not cut another one off, and it had to be advanced a little bit to get the next one off. And to advance it, the hub was made out of metal. You'd hold your hand on that hub for about 5 seconds and heat it up a degree or so, and the thermal expansion of that coming out was enough to give the thickness of what he wanted. And then, since it was so thin, in order to prevent that from flopping all over the place, that was watered back behind it, and it would float on top of the water, so they could remove it and put it in an electron microscope in order to observe the structure of it. It was just absolutely unbelievable. When people would need to get a haircut, he would go down to Bogotá and bring a barber up, and they would do the haircuts up there. And it was that. He had all the money directly from P.J. Jimenez. And as a consequence, the university had nothing to do with it, but wanted everything to do with it. And they were very, very jealous of his being able to get money, and they could not get money. Well, I went back down and after the interview and about ready to come back home, and then the revolution began. And I was downtown at the time the first thing was happening, and saw these buses like that. I stayed in my hotel room, of course. And they knew that I should probably be away from downtown, so they were able to get a car down to the hotel and take me up and stay up there for the duration. All the airports were closed. It became extremely nationalistic. They attacked all foreign embassies which were there or tried to Molotov cocktails to them. It was an unbelievable situation. We went back up to the mountain, and the next night, this went on for 2 or 3 days, I guess. He was afraid that some of the people from the university, which was at the center of this communist revolution, liberals at the university, would come up there and try to take over the place. Well, the only way you could get up there was a narrow road that opened up when you got up to the top of the mountain. And he had all kinds of equipment. He drove himself one of the bulldozers down and blocked the access. And his scouts raided down there, and sure enough, there was a truckload of people that came up, saw that, and they turned around and went back and didn't come up. It was that close. Another event while I was up there, during this several-day period, was he had a fella from a company in the United States to be in charge of the construction that was going on. Very, very big construction company, but he was the person who could speak Spanish and do that. And they were digging a ditch so wide and so deep. And unfortunately, it collapsed and buried 3 people under there. And they started digging furiously, and they didn't know how many people were under there, but they got all 3 out. None of them were seriously damaged. But during that period, you could hear all of these Mexicans who were doing the labor stuff. Mistake of a foreign engineer, and it was, again, I'll say unbelievable. I'll tell you a bit more about Fernandez Moran there before I finish that story. When he would come up to talk to the consultants in Dunedin, Florida, they would tell us after he had gone back down what type of person he was. He knew, having grown up in Europe, 5 different languages, and he could dictate in all of those. This is the time you take a dictaphone with you and you have a little tape in it, and he would dictate in this language and another one, and he would send it back to his secretary to transcribe it and to mail it out in South America. I mean, he was just busy all the time, rarely slept. He would get a good idea up there, the scientists would tell me, And he thought nothing about calling someone at 2 o'clock saying, we got to go and try this. And they'd get up at 2 o'clock and go try it. An intense, very, very extremely intense individual. Well, I finally was able to get through to a phone call to dear Leonor. And it was at the time they did not have any underground cables. And it was on radio telephone. And you're dependent on what the transmission is. And I faded in and faded out and faded in. And Leonor was sure that I was in the hospital. She was home with the three children and at that time. So the revolution occurred, and it was clear that nothing's going to take place for a long time. And it was clear that he was going to have to leave. And sure enough, a week or two later, he and his family left the place. And he was sought after at the University of Chicago, and he ended up as a professor researching in their biological area at the University of Chicago. I didn't stay in touch with Fernandez Moran, but I opened up we got a Time magazine or a Newsweek magazine, and on the front page of that, on one cover page, was a photograph of a rosette type of structure that no one thought could ever be observed with an electron microscope. And I opened it up, and there was a full article on Fernandez Moran, who had accomplished that. And the way that he had done it was to, with an ultramicrotome, but the key was to get the diamond sliver sharp enough that it could cut without crushing the thing. And he had spent 3 years with a special diamond sliver, honing it on the strap like you had honed your razor, until he got the edge that he thought he could do it, and he achieved that. And later on, when I ended up at the university, again, this is about Fernandez Moran, I'll get back to leaving Venezuela in a moment. When I was assistant dean from 64 to 68 for the School of Physical Sciences and Applied Mathematics, they had a lot of joint activities that interdisciplinary activities that would involve justifying buying an instrument like an electron microscope that could be used by a variety of laboratories around campus. And being in the dean's office, I would be the one that sort of would help coordinate people who would come in and talk about it. And they had money to do that. And one of the companies that wanted us to buy from them was Perkin Elmer. And the Perkin Elmer representative came in with me, and I told him who would be the proper ones to discuss this in the various departments. And when it was electron microscope, I told him my story about Fernandez Moran there in my office, in the dean's office. And he said, Fernandez Moran? We know Fernandez Moran. When he came up to the University of Chicago and established his laboratory, he was in the market for some electron microscopes. And it was a competition between several companies that did it. And he ended up selecting Perkin Elmer. And he said that his selection of Perkin Elmer sold more electron microscopes for Perkin Elmer than any salesman for the entire year. So that's the kind of person that had this laboratory, as you can understand.
What an endorsement.
I know. So we finally got back, and I got in touch with the consultants, and he said that Fernandez Moran had left. They're going to have another director. They're going to have another search. The other two never got down for the end of the year. And that, as to whether if they had offered it to me, I felt like they would, since I was the first one. And my wife being Spanish and speaking Spanish, I think I probably might have gone down there. But that job got closed out, and that probably is in part why I came to North Carolina State University, back to my stomping ground.
Back to your alma mater?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the...
And how did you get your teaching position at NC State University?
Oh, I had that offer already in hand at the time I went down for that interview. I had two or three offers at the time, and that was the last one that I wanted to explore before making my final decision. I had a couple of industrial offers. They wanted me to stay also at Wright-Patterson as a civil servant on a GS scale in the same activity that I was in. Mm-hmm.
And what year did you start at State, NC State?
It was in 1952. I guess I could tell another coincidence or story. It probably took World War II to get the two of us together, because it was during World War II that the atomic bomb was developed and got my interest in nuclear physics and into the first nuclear engineering program in the world, which was graduating the class of 52. After that was accomplished, the Vannevar Bush, who was the president of MIT, he was a top electrical engineer. He co-authored one of the textbooks that I used at NC State, Vannevar Bush, Timby and Bush, in my freshman electrical engineering course. My professor there who taught it was a student of Bush up at MIT, and he was revising the book, and it became out Timby, Bush, and Hoadley after he had revised it. And during my junior summer, he asked me and a colleague, John Mayo, who later became vice president for Bell Telephone Labs, if we would work all of the problems in that sophomore electrical engineering textbook. He wanted to have an answer book and publish that along with the book. So that's how I spent my first summer before coming, my last summer before graduating, I guess, working on those in Brown Summit at home. Well, Bush, after World War II was over, was advisor to the President Truman. He was asked, now what should we do with all of this talent that has been developed in Los Alamos, at Oak Ridge, and all over, to take advantage of all of this talent from a federal level and encourage the United States to make use of that. And Vannevar Bush told him we should create a National Science Foundation, and went on to say what should be done with the National Science Foundation. And they created the National Science Foundation, and that would have been like 51 or 50 during that time period after World War II. And it was the National Science Foundation that was created at Vannevar Bush's insistence that was responsible for creating predoctoral graduate fellowships in the sciences. And they offered the first ones to the class of 1952. And I was fortunate enough to get one of those. And that's what allowed me to go to Berkeley after I graduated from NC State.
So the fellowship scholarship paid for how many years of your education?
It was 1 year at a time.
Okay.
And I had to request it renewed after my first semester, which I got all A's and got my professors to write letters, and they renewed it for the second year. I had an ROTC commission after graduating from NC State in 52, and most people who get those have an immediate mandatory military obligation as a second lieutenant to serve whatever the period was. My period was for 2 years, and most of the people did that. Mine was in the Air Force, and the Air Force was a very forward-thinking group. They had a Air Force Institute of Technology up at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. It was the group that actually sent 30 of their officers down in the first class of nuclear engineering to get that program started at the graduate level in 1 year with 30 graduate students.
Impressive.
They were very forward-thinking. I had my scholarship in hand, and I asked could I get a delay in going to military service so I could get my PhD in physics out at Berkeley. And that delay was called a Category C delay, only available through the Air Force. And they gave me a Category C delay. Again, that was 1 year at a time. Now, I had after graduating, a two-year obligation to serve, and I had a five-year obligation in the reserve total, of which two needed to be on active duty. So I had to complete my 2 years of military active duty, doing that 5 years after graduating. Well, at the end of, I got my second National Science Foundation predoctoral fellowship, which covered everything for me. And then time came at the end of that, I was ready to start my research. And I was fortunate to get a research assistantship at the Lawrence Radiation Laboratory on campus, right off the campus in Berkeley, in nuclear physics, which is my major interest developed through the nuclear engineering program at NC State. So I didn't need NSF support after the first 2 years. But I still needed to get a delay for my third year. And I sent that off, and they asked, when would you finish? Well, at the end of my first year, I talked to a lot of graduate students in Berkeley. This guy had been there 4 years, he still had two or three to go. This guy had been there 5 years, and he still hadn't completed his dissertation. And I really got sort of discouraged. I knew that I could not stay out there and finish a PhD during the time that these people were spending associated with graduating. And I even considered, after we got married in June, going to Hartford, Connecticut, to coming back to NC State to get my PhD in physics for the remaining time to do that. But I decided I would go back and spend double time in getting my degree. And they gave me the third year, and it was clear that I was going to need some more time. And I didn't know how much more time that it would take. And they gave me the third year, and essentially told me that at the end of the third year, I had to do my 2 years of active duty because I only had a five-year obligation. And I asked them, could I possibly get that 5 years of reserve that I was obligated for, extended for two more years to have a total of seven, in case I didn't make it in 3 years? And they said, that sounds like a good idea, and they were able to work that out. So the pressure was not quite there to do it in 3 years. And the time came up for another delay in going to active duty, and I asked for another year, and they said, we'll give you a semester. So I spent 3 years and a semester to get my PhD at Berkeley. And it just finished in the nick of time.
And in the meantime, you got your master's after the first year?
At Berkeley, yeah, a master's along the way. That's sort of a consolation prize. They accept only people into the PhD program at Berkeley, and many people do it the other way. And you can get a master's if you complete the coursework and do a test. You don't have to do a dissertation, right? But I worked round the clock.
And you had a wife and a child?
Well,
at home
Kevin
at the time.
Came in 55, yeah. Real interesting about Kevin, I would have my card table that was my desk in the living room at this upstairs apartment, which we drove by, I think, the street when we were out there. And he would crawl on the floor. We left when he was, before he was 1 year, 55, I guess, yeah, before he was 1 year old. And he was about 9 months, and he would come up to the card table and grab hold of the leg and pull up like this, and then put his hands across the top of the card table. And that guy chinned and pulled himself up, and I saw his face pull up at that very young age. Before he could walk, he could do that. So we were partners. He had colic, unfortunately, poor fellow. So he had a late... He stayed up late at night. I stayed up late at night, so it was...
He kept you company.
He kept his company, so that worked out very well. But the most interesting thing about him was when we had him baptized at a church in Oakland. He was just only a few months... maybe he was 6 months old, something like that. But when he would pull up like that, or he would look at me like that, I would always talk to him and try to get him to do something, learn something. And I said, where is your tongue? And I would stick my tongue out at him. Where is your tongue? And I would stick out my tongue. And he actually learned how to do that. Well, when we had the baptism of Kevin, the priest came a time, he wanted to put some salt on his head and said, "Where's your tongue?" And Kevin stuck his tongue out, the priest put salt on it, and he said, "In all my life, I've never seen the thing." It was unbelievable. So that was quite interesting.
So he answered the priest.
Yes, yes, he stuck his tongue out. He couldn't speak, but he knew the words. Well, that's fascinating. Well, there's some other interesting stories, but I think this is enough for me right now.
Thank you. I enjoyed the narrative.
Well, Cooper and Nydia, it's been our pleasure.
Well, this is
thank you so much for
a lot of fun.
Recording this for whoever's interested.